குடியுரிமை சட்ட திருத்தம் குறித்து மக்களுக்கு இது குறித்த உண்மையான செய்தியை சொல்வதற்காக பல பத்திரிகையாளர் கூட்டங்கள் ஏற்பாடாகியிருக்கிறது. அதனுடைய ஒரு பங்காக இன்று சென்னைக்கு திரு சித்தார்த்நாத் சிங் அவர்கள், அவர் பல ஆண்டுகள் தேசிய அளவிலே பத்திரிகை தொடர்பாளராக இருந்து மிக அனுபவம் மிக்கவர், தேசிய செயலாளராக இருந்தார். தற்பொழுது உத்தரப்பிரதேச மாநிலத்தில் சிறு மற்றும் குறு தொழில்கள் அமைச்சராக பணியாற்றி வருகிறார். அவர் இப்பொழுது உங்களிடையே பேசுகிறார்.
தேங்க்யூ. ஃபர்ஸ்ட்லி ஹாப்பி பொங்கல் டு எவ்ரிபடி ஹியர். ஐ எம் ஹியர் டு டாக் அபவுட் சிட்டிசன்ஸ் அமெண்ட்மெண்ட் ஆக்ட். And just to give a little background to it, after Modi ji came in government, since 2014, and before that Modi ji came, there was a phase, a political narrative which was largely used as vote bank politics, or sometimes we used it as appeasement politics. Modi ji changed that into a constructive politics, or through social welfare schemes that needs to be delivered. And in that, many schemes he brought down. That was like the basically like toilets, housing, Prime Minister housing, Ujala, that's the gas connections, then Saubhagya, the electricity connections. Very importantly, the Ayushman Bharat. And the people of this country, they realized, and particularly these schemes, because they were never a target group, but it applied as based on the 2011 census. Largely, the beneficiaries of these schemes were the Dalits and the minorities, particularly the Muslims. Because of the constructive political governance of Modi ji, gradually these voters coming from this segment, they started shifting towards the BJP, and the result of 2019 is an example that it had happened. The country has seen a development politics coming, and that became the narrative. With that, many things in this country which had been pending for many years. Article 370, it was abrogated. Triple talaq, so many times the Supreme Court has spoken. Triple talaq bill came in. Then we saw the Ram Janmabhoomi, 500 years dispute, getting settled peacefully. So all these three things which were used by the opposition to put BJP in corner and create a fear through their falsehood among the minorities, they found it is coming to an end. And with this, the country saw the Citizen Amendment Bill coming in. The Citizen Amendment Bill, once it got passed, somehow the opposition, in democracy, the protests are always welcome. But in the name of protest, certain parts of the country, and we saw that in Delhi, we saw in some parts of Karnataka, we saw in Uttar Pradesh, Bengal, many other areas, that all these states saw a protest which was violent. There was violence with that, and it was a planned violence. So that a fear once again can be created among the minorities. And the fear was basically and largely saying that, look, if you pass this bill, the minorities of this country will be asked to go back either to Pakistan or Bangladesh or Afghanistan. That's what the bill is all about. So this is how the Citizenship Amendment Act played out in the public by the opposition by creating a fear through spreading falsehood and fear-mongering. And therefore, BJP decided to put an end to this spread of falsehood. And from 5th of January to 20th of January, 255 press conferences are being held throughout the country. And in that relation, I am also here. And there are other programs also related with that. We are going to contact 3 crore houses. There will be mobilization of 10 lakh workers we have done of the BJP. So all these things we have. And as it is coming to a close, I'm already on 17th, we are realizing it has given an impact. The people of this country are appreciating because the right message is going. And in that, the fourth pillar of our constitution, which is a strong pillar, that's the media, has always been a great help to us by spreading the right or giving the right viewpoint. But let me put this, that we have seen that the Congress and the left parties time and again have used a falsehood campaign, and we saw when something was happening in Uttar Pradesh when BJP was not in government, and it happened in Dadri, and they made it as a campaign, it was as the center was doing. And we came, there was something called award Wapsi campaign. So that kind of, you know, as if the country was going through a bad turmoil and things like this. So, but on the Citizenship Amendment Bill, let me put this. The history itself speaks about it. There was a Nehru-Liaquat Pact in 1950, which assured the minorities of each country. And when I say minorities of each country, is through the partition, so that we don't get confused. Through the partition of India, and in that it was an assurance that each country will take care. Pakistan, now well, Bangladesh also, but that time Pakistan and Afghanistan, they decided to be an Islamic country based on religion. India decided to be a secular, and we are all happy that we are secular. But unfortunately, that never got honored by Pakistan and now Bangladesh also. And the records are showing that those Hindus or the minorities who decided to remain part of Pakistan, Bangladesh and Afghanistan, the population, demographic population had been dwindling. To give a little example, the Muslim population in Pakistan was all about 79.2%, and the balance were the minorities at the time of partition. But we come to 2015 census, the Muslim population in Pakistan is 96.5%, the balance are minorities. Similarly, in Bangladesh, if you look at the Muslim population was 76.9% in 1951, and today they are plus 90%. So similarly, the minorities have been coming down. And they all are because of religious oppression on them. And since the Nehru-Liaquat Pact did not work, various leaders, and it is not the BJP leaders per se, But there have been various leaders, including Nehruji, including Indira Gandhi, including many leaders of the CPI, like Prakash Karat. They all have spoken in favor of giving a citizenship to those who are coming from Bangladesh, Pakistan and Afghanistan as refugees, not as intruders. There is a international convention which differentiates between an intruder and a refugee. And based on that, the Citizenship Act has been prepared. And I can only say that from this state, Mr. Chidambaram also comes. And Mr. Chidambaram, when he was the Home Minister, and a lot of videos have been in circulation, I don't need to repeat all about them, but he has been an advocate on citizenship amendment. He has been an advocate on NRC. He has been an advocate on NPR. He has absolutely made a U-turn. Similarly, in Assam, the then the Chief Minister in 2012 wrote a letter to Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and said that we need to resolve the issue of citizenship for the Bengali Hindus, the Buddhists, the Christians, because they are minority communities and they have been treated inhumanly, and those after the partition of India. So there's enough history to it. It's not that the BJP is something doing new. BJP has just taken it forward on the various times the parliament has debated, various leaders have debated on the Citizenship Amendment Act. There have been number of issues which have been raised on CAA. I'll request my media department to circulate this to all of you, which answers certain questions, which actually are the questions which the opposition is throwing in the public domain and creating confusion. So I will be giving this, and it is all relates to the CAA. Does it affect the Indian citizens? None of the Indian citizens gets affected, whether it's the majority or the minority. It doesn't even, not even a single clause or a word talks about that any Indian needs to go back. It doesn't even speak about that. It just speaks about the minorities who are coming here as refugees from Bangladesh, Pakistan and Afghanistan who have come here, taken shelter, living inhuman. How do we give them a citizenship? So that's all it has been speaking. Then it has spoken, there's a number of questions. Will illegal Muslim immigrants from these three countries be deported under the CAA? No, it doesn't. Even the illegal Muslims who have entered, there is a different act related to it. It doesn't go through the CAA. You know, there's enough, a lot of clarification has been given. So I'm sure this will help you to understand. The CAA will gradually exclude Indian Muslims from the citizenship of India. That kind of questions have been raised. The answer is very clear. Certainly it's not no, but more detailing has been given by us. Doesn't India have an obligation under the UN to take charge of refugees? We are not signatory to it. That's also a reality. We must accept it. India is not a signatory to the UN Convention of 1951. And the UN Protocol of 1967 of refugees. So we have to, a number of debates which we are seeing. And it's been, how does Indian treats the Baluchis? How the Indian treats the Ahmadiyyas in Pakistan? Rohingyas of Myanmar? What law will apply there? does this cover or any other law? So it's been answered here. We are not treating them that they will be just thrown out. There's a law for it. If they apply under that law, they will be covered. So we are not treating them inhumanly. But there, this particular act relates to these three countries. So I'm sure you will like to go through all these questions which are in the public domain by the opposition and the answers that we are giving. And I would only just say that it's time that the opposition parties here who have been in the government in the past and their leaders, Mr. Stalin and others, they should now refrain from spreading falsehood on the CAA. They should accept that the CAA is nothing to do with the Indian citizens. Perhaps, in my opinion, they do know about it. That it has nothing to do with the Indian citizens, irrespective of the religion they come from. But they wish to spread a falsehood. And there is no NCR which is related with the CAA. And there is no NPR related with the CAA. They all are separate issues. They will be dealt separately and with all the stakeholders. This is all from my side. If there are any questions, I'll try to answer.
Sir, you said that you are going to hit 3 crore houses you are targeting. Are you going to go along with your aligned party leaders too?
This is a BJP campaign. It's a BJP campaign, but if any alliance partner wishes to join, they're always welcome.
Sir, there is a big question in Tamil Nadu that the Nilam peoples are need for the dual citizenship. Is the government is ready to go on that? Or
well,
have any discussion on
that? Well, every geopolitical issues need to be dealt along with that region and the neighboring. As far as the CAA relates to those three countries only. Time and again, we have addressed on the refugee status or the Tamils from the Sri Lanka. If I recall correctly, there have been more than 2 accords also. So the country will always address as and when, but separately they will address. So it depends. It largely takes care on the state governments, how they interact, how they talk to the government, central government, and the central government will accordingly then come up with the answer. That's what I'm saying. So you do a press conference, next day we say, yeah, we are announcing. It doesn't happen that way. There's all serious issues.
Sorry. See, CAA and NRC are the twins, as P. Chidambaram has told.
Well, that's again, I say, my apologies. It's a lovely language, but I wish I could learn Tamil, and that will be very nice of me to do that. So my apology, I cannot answer in that. Mr. Chidambaram, if you see his interview with Shekhar Gupta on the YouTube, he has actually said that the CAA citizenship amendment has nothing to do with NRC. Now the same person is taking a U-turn and now saying they are related. It's very, very unfortunate.
Born together, twins.
And misleading the country. Now for what reason? He should answer. So I think Mr. Chidambaram, with the political status he has in the country, he shouldn't be misleading the citizens.
Sir, as you know, 2 days before DMK skips to opposition meeting, which is against CAA, would you think there is a clashing opposition on fight against CAA? Do you think so? Already Congress and DMK is on a clash?
Well, I think that's for the Congress and DMQ to decide. They are in alliance. But I it seems that the alliance is frittering away somewhere. And so for them it decide, and those who are changing their mind are always, as BJP will always say, you're welcome to change your mind. Because we have seen many leaders now in opposition have changed their mind and they have been attacking CA.
That means
I've never said, I've not spoken about the alliance. I've spoken about only the viewpoint on CA. Well, this is exactly what we are doing. So we are reaching out to them. It's our outreach campaign, and media is also part of the outreach campaign to answer many of the questions. And in the universities also, we are approaching through our various fronts, and I'm sure the country is responding to it. They won't? But I think again, you see, sometimes it happens that in politics a drum is beaten and a lot of people start walking on the tune of the drum. So our good friends also perhaps have got carried away, but the BJP has not brought anything on the NRC so far. What has happened in Assam was under the direction of the Supreme Court. If Rajiv Gandhi had fulfilled it, that accord in Assam in 1985, which he had signed, this NRC wouldn't have taken place, because that's exactly what he was supposed to do. He backed out. So the Supreme Court pushed for the NRC and we did that. So BJP as a government, and again I repeat, the BJP as a government has never spoken about the NRC in the country, or we are going to implement it. Yes, he did. We all can see what he had said in the parliament. We are not denying. But as a government, we have never taken a call or any discussion or with the stakeholders or anyone has happened. And I think the Prime Minister has made it very, very clear. No, but we are not denying. We are not saying that NRC may not come. I'm not saying here. I'm not saying that NRC may not come. NRC may come, but again, whenever it is will come, it will be in the discussion with everybody and then debated, and through the parliament it will come. So it's too far now. So as of today, somebody is saying that if you allow me, I'll just give you a little anecdote. There were two people started fighting that there's going to be too much of spice in the, you know, food. The police fellow came in. The police fellow came, he said, where's the cook? I will taste the food and then I'll find. So they said, no, it's going to be cooked tomorrow. So something which is not been ready here is going to be cooked sometime later. Let us wait for it. That's exactly, we are clearing the fear. But NRC is nothing to do with the Hindu Sikhs and all that. Again, and Amit Shah ji has never spoken about NRC at length in the parliament. He has only spoken about the CAA has been debated in the parliament, that act of the cab has been passed as CAA. And let me also add, if you go back in 2010, 2012, when Chidambaram was the Home Minister, he has also given interviews on NRC. But that didn't mean that he brought it. the cabinet, then the parliament, everybody has to approve it, and a lot of things have to be spoken. So the confusion which is being created that CAA is a first step and next step it gets in related or they are twins is not there. This is exactly what the clarification we are bringing up. Certainly, Tamil Nadu will also have a president, but for that, our central parliamentary party meets, and based on that, they will announce it. So I am sure we'll all. I am sure with the new president coming in next week, his formal announcement. Well, he will be formally taking oath, and we'll also have it somewhere, something here. Very soon, very soon. You'll all come to know.
Which was brought up by the UPA.
I didn't understand that.
The NRC and MRC, which we are not against on that, we have brought that. And Chidambaram also accept that we have brought that.
Yeah.
And the question which was increased.
Increased what?
It is not relevant to the NPR or NRC. The older questions are between Sabupri questions, and you are added 7 more questions on that. And that is not relevant to the NRP or NRC. It is against the law of.
No, but again, there is no formulation on the NRC. Nothing has been worked out or a single paper has been worked out and given in the public domain that this is the paper based on which the NRC is going to be conducted. So I don't know from where the, if that, my understanding is very clear what you have said. So Mr. Chidambaram, from where he's got it and his understanding, I don't know. Now, as far as the NPR is concerned, NPR is a population that whoever is staying in the country have to give, and it can be done online. Your own self attestation or declaration is an acceptable form of it. So I don't see that to be a problem also, but population register is a separate register, and NRC is a kind of a, in fact, they all had started in 2010, they gave up in 2011 and they brought in Aadhaar card. And we had said that how you have wasted 1 year, UPA 2, you have wasted 1 year, you have spent so much of money, why you are changing it towards Aadhaar? So there is a whole history. So I don't see from where Mr. Chidambaram is coming up and why he is bringing these issues when none of us has seen what is the format or the template of the NRC.
Since you brought up Aadhaar, there was a report that said the government will not consider things like passport or the voter's ID as proof of citizenship. Is there such a
problem? Well, I think I personally feel that it will be right for all of us that we should wait for the NRC to happen and the government to formulate the policy, pass it and give the procedures out. Till that doesn't happen and the act coming in, we should not be getting confused about it and then, you know, assuming things. Assumption wouldn't be the right thing to be done.
So the video releasing way, Assam, one media power,
you see, I haven't seen that, so I can't really comment on that. But these are all technology based. Some errors are accepted, but the errors will be always corrected. Well, I think we are doing, the Prime Minister is all, you see, the Prime Minister has already initiated a dialogue with many industries. We are coming up with the budget, and in that budget, a lot of exercise is being done by the finance minister, and I believe the finance minister is also coming next 2 days. She'll be interacting with all of you. And so the government is conscious. There are reasons for the slowdown, but yes, there is a slowdown, and the government is conscious about the matter, and we are sensitive, and the government has taken a number of steps so far and needs to take further more steps, and that's been debated. With the budget coming in, I think we'll be able to address that, and the sentiments of the in the country is needs to be pulled up, which with the exercise the Prime Minister has already undertaken a few days back, meeting the industries. I think that will help the sentiments to be uplifted. That's what I'm saying. We are giving important. If the Prime Minister is meeting the industry people, that they are certainly, it's an important. How can a government sleep over it? There's no slumbering in the BJP on the economic front or the development front or the governance front. We have been, and there is also, there is no paralysis in the governance. We have seen paralysis in the UPA too. But not in the Modi government. We are active. It's an active government and will always adjust to the requirement, economic needs.
Sir, you said that there are a lot of violence which has been happening in the recent protest against this CAA. And is there any inputs which have been initiated to move initiated this protest? I mean, we have seen.
Well, at least I can speak. Very authentically about in Uttar Pradesh, since I come from there, I'm a minister in there. The PFI, which is a band, time and again it's been banned. They had links with the SIMI. They have been involved into this, and the names with the records have been forwarded to the Home Ministry for banning them again. So we have found that. So and therefore I said it's been a falsehood campaign, and but at the same time it's a very planned campaign that was organized in the name of protest. I would relate both of them together.
Rohit.
Well, I don't know why you are saying for the BJP's tolerance, but as far as the no government will do against its own people, but I wish you had spoken about the tolerance among many of the opposition parties who have led this campaign.
Okay. Last question.
Many can have their own individual views, and I don't think very seriously very senior people in the BJP, now again I'm clarifying that in the BJP, have spoken like this, but anything, everybody has a view, many articles are written about many things. The government is considers and is of the opinion that JNU is a premium organization. It's an institution which has given very stalwarts in this country. And any premium institutions, the ethos needs to be maintained. And I'm sure the government is committed in maintaining that.